welcome back to another week of the Sports Shift. Well, Brylin, it was an emotional roller coaster here in Philadelphia.
It really was.
This week, to say the least. Business was done, both with the Flyers, with the Phillies, and the Eagles.
Absolutely.
And, you know, what do we have going on? Before we get to that, what do we have going on in the Sweet 16?
Well, Ria, it was also a very emotional, it's been an emotional March Madness, to say the least. Michigan and Villanova will be the first game to tip off in San Antonio on Thursday, March 24th, in the Sweet 16 of the NCAA Men's Basketball Tournament. The matchup, part of the South region, is set to start at 7:30 p.m. and will air on TBS. So, you know, it's just a lot of crazy things happening. And
everyone's rooting go Nova. But to continue with all the March Madness, number 5 Notre Dame danced their way into the Sweet 16, defeating number 4 Oklahoma 108-64, becoming the first team in NCAA history, men or women's, to beat a higher seed by 40-plus points. Dara Mabry scored a season-high of 29 points, setting the pace early against the third nationally ranked team for shooting and a reputation for forcing a fast tempo. This is just one of the many bracket-busting upsets that have occurred throughout this tournament, isn't it, Brylin?
Yes, literally the men and women are both, there's no perfect brackets left, which I think is, I feel like we're a lot closer to the championship when there's still a couple brackets, but no, there's no perfect brackets left, which means it's just that's why they call it March Madness.
All the more thrilling.
Exactly. And kind of turning the tables a little bit, three-time Masters champion Phil Mickelson announced he will not compete at the Masters next month at Augusta National Golf Club, marking the first time since 1994. The decision comes with controversy since last month when the six-time major champion criticized the PGA Tour and said he was involved in drawing up the working agreement for a breakaway league being financed by Saudi Arabia's public investment fund. In it, Mickelson described the Saudis as scary, but said he was looking past their controversial history of human rights violations to gain leverage with the PGA Tour. Like, excuse me? His comments drew widespread criticism, as they should, in leading him to apologize days later. Sponsors such as Callaway and KPMG also ended their partnerships with him. He has not stepped out on the links to play since February 6th, stating that he desperately needs to sort out his priorities, and that is so. And, you know, I really liked Phil Mickelson. My dad, like, loves golf, so I kind of grew up watching it. It was on the TV, and like, since that, I was just like, come on, Phil. Yeah. Like, why? Like, why? Why would you say that?
Right. But, just needs to step away and work on himself. Absolutely. So, like you said, sort out his priorities. Yeah. And maybe he has something personal going on, and hopefully he'll come back maybe better. A better person and a better player.
Absolutely.
But a new era is upon us. The Flyers made 2 deals ahead of Monday's 3 p.m. trade deadline, although their remake of the team truly started earlier that week with the trade of longtime captain Claude Giroux for power forward Owen Tippett and 2 future draft picks from the Florida Panthers. On Monday, the team sent 2 impending unrestricted free agents, defenseman Justin Braun, to the New York Rangers in exchange for a 2023 third-round draft pick. And Derek Brassard, now on his 10th team, might I mention, to the Edmonton Oilers for a 2023 fourth-round pick. General manager Chuck Fletcher stated, "I think it went exactly as we expected. We had been receiving a lot of calls on Justin Braun, so we expected that we would be able to move him. Derek Brassard, on the other hand, a versatile veteran forward who has played in an awful lot of playoff games, he also expected that the Flyers would move them as well. So Owen Tippett, in exchange for Claude Giroux, played his first game for the Orange and Black on Sunday, and he seemed to fit in right perfectly. Aside from the bank statements, club shared some injury updates Tuesday ahead of the game in Detroit. With the trades of Claude Giroux and Derek Brassard, the Flyers were short a forward Tuesday night, but they're expecting to have Nate Thompson cleared by Thursday for his return to the lineup. So reinforcements coming in, injuries coming back. And the 37-year-old center has been rehabbing back from shoulder surgery he had in late November. Scott Lawton, on the other hand, has been back on the ice and joined the club on its road trip after suffering a concussion March 10th. Mm-hmm. So hopefully, you know, now that the playoff contention is pretty much done for the Flyers.
Yeah.
They look ahead to next season.
They're rebuilding now. And yes. I think this whole trade deadline, I think it helped
yeah.
them. They're looking to the future.
Yes. I think the future is bright. And they took the ice last night with the new changes and suffered a 6-3 loss to the Red Wings in Detroit. Now the Flyers' playmaking wasn't all that bad until they pulled the goalie in the third. With poor defensive and offensive execution in front of the net, they handed Detroit two empty netters to cap off the 6-3 takeaway. Mike Yeo's club went down 3-0 only 1:07 into the second period, but made it a game with answers from Joel Farabee and Oscar Lindblom. With Detroit holding on a 4-2 lead in the third period, James Van Riemsdyk trimmed it to 1, and the Flyers have yet to win one on the road in the year of 2022. Their last victory away from home was December 29th when they beat the Seattle Kraken 3-2. The Flyers have gone 0-11-2 on the road since then, a stretch in which they've been outscored 57-29. So, Brylin, the Orange and Black have 5 games left on this road swing, and it continues tomorrow night with a back-to-back starting in St. Louis on Thursday with the Blues, and then right back at it in Colorado on Friday.
Like you said, this is a long road trip. They still have a few games to go, so maybe they can change momentum. They can build that team chemistry with the new ones, you know, here and there on the road, and, you know, hopefully they can change things and kind of just take this season and, like, sit with it, work on it, fix what they need to, build chemistry, and then take it to next season. But, you know, Ria, like you said, a lot of changes have been made in Philly, and Nick Sirianni just added another favorite to his roster. The Eagles on Monday signed free agent wide receiver Zach Pascal. Pascal, 27, is a longtime favorite of Nick Sirianni, who spent the 2018 through 2020 seasons with Pascal in Indianapolis and often spoke in glowing terms about Pascal while sharing his longish stories of his Colts days with the Philly media. Pascal has 150 catches for 1,888 yards and 15 touchdowns with a 12.6 average in 4 years with the Colts, who originally signed him as an undrafted free agent out of Old Dominion, where he played alongside Travis Fulham in 2015 and 2016. He's also considered one of the best blocking receivers in the league. Pascal started out his Colts career as a special teamer before working his way into the offense late his rookie year. In his best years, Pascal had 41 catches for 607 yards and 5 touchdowns in 2020, playing with Jacoby Brissett, and 44 for 629 and 5 touchdowns in 2020, playing with Philip Rivers. He was one of only 10 receivers to catch at least 40 passes and average over 14 yards per catch in both 2019 and 2020. Last year, with Carson Wentz as his QB and Sirianni no longer on the Colts coaching staff, he dropped to a 38 catches for 384 yards and 3 touchdowns. One thing this signing does is bump Jalen Reagor down to the 4th seed wide receiver on the Eagles roster, at best behind Smith, Watkins, and Pascal. In addition to Smith, Watkins, Pascal, and Reagor, the Eagles also have J.J. Arcega-Whiteside, Greg Ward, John Hightower, Deion Kane on the roster. And at 27, going into his 5th year, Pascal becomes the Eagles' oldest and most experienced Eagles wide receiver in designation, previously held by the 26-year-old Ward. So there's a lot with this new addition, and I think he's going to bring, you know, the energy and, you know, like we said, the veteran that the Eagles need to take them to the next level.
Yes. I think all these new faces, they're good. They're refreshing on all the Philadelphia teams.
Change is good.
It definitely is. And it there is no doubt that this MLB offseason, teams are wasting no time making up for the time they lost during the lockout. Teams are buying in big to free agency this spring, and the Phillies are certainly one of those clubs spending the big bucks. The Phillies made a series of promising signings this week that began with relievers Brad Hand and Jeurys Familia, continued with Kyle Schwarber, and culminated with the shocking addition of Nick Castellanos, who agreed Friday night to a five-year, $100 million deal. The Phillies brought in Schwarber and Castellanos on deals worth a combined $179 million over 9 years. With Castellanos and Schwarber, who are each capable of hitting 30 homers or driving in 100 runs, Harper doesn't need to carry the offense for months as he did in 2021. JT Realmuto doesn't have to be relied upon as the cleanup hitter or second-best run producer. He can settle more naturally now into a complementary offensive role. The Phillies are about $10 million over the $230 million luxury tax. And if they spent nothing more between now and the end of the season, they'd pay a penalty of approximately $2 million. Since this would be their first year exceeding the tax, they'd be subject to the lowest penalty of 20%. This is relevant because the Phillies will still have a ton of money committed toward 2023 and 2024, and if they do progress into becoming an actual contender, the spending won't just stop. With these elite additions up and down the lineup, Phillies players should feel less pressure and execute at their best. So, hopefully. Very exciting. Definitely a more in-depth lineup.
Yeah,
contribution absolutely. On all areas.
Yeah.
I'm excited.
I'm excited too, and I think it's really important for Harper and Realmuto, like, they have a lot of pressure on them because, you know, they're the big names.
Right.
And these new additions give themselves a chance to, you know, show us what you got.
Yes.
And, you know, help the team out a little bit.
And especially fan appeal. I know Castellanos is like, and Schwarber, they're both like fan favorites. Mm-hmm. So they will fit in just nicely here in Philadelphia.
Oh, yeah. I'm sure.
They'll feel the brotherly love in no time.
Well, it was a thrill ride Monday night at the Wells Fargo Center, and all because of this guy, Tyrese Maxey. He played like an all-star, helping the Sixers compensate for the absences of James Harden and Joel Embiid to beat the Eastern Conference leading Miami Heat in a thrilling game. With Harden sidelined by left hamstring injury recovery and Embiid for back soreness, Maxey was incredible. Down the stretch in a 113-106 win, he finished with 28 points, 5 rebounds, and 4 assists. It was an impressive, improbable response by the Sixers to a disappointing loss Sunday to the Raptors. Paul Millsap started for the 746th time in his NBA career and his first time since May 7th of last year. It was his first game action of any kind since the Sixers' March 5th loss in Miami. That was also the last occasion Korkmaz received rotation minutes before Monday. Shake Milton had 20 points, 6 assists, and only one turnover in 31 minutes off the bench. Furkan Korkmaz put up 18 points. Jimmy Butler scored 27. Bam posted 22, and Kyle Lowry with 20. Miami was without Victor and due to back spasms, and Gabe Vincent because of his right big toe contusion. The Sixers will start a 3-game road trip tonight against the Lakers for a late tip-off at 10 p.m. So just like the Flyers, hopefully they can kind of, you know, they're on the road,
yeah.
They can get some momentum going,
yeah.
And I really think that win against Miami Heat will help them a lot.
Oh, for sure, and to see Tyrese Maxey, like, showing out, that has to speak volumes to
Absolutely.
The rest of his team.
Absolutely.
Stepping up, big shoes to fill with Joel Embiid and Harden out, so.
And for, like, other teams, they're only worried about Joel Embiid and James Harden, but
yes.
Now they're like, oh, no, like, this Tyrese Maxey kid,
yeah,
where is he coming
watch
from?
Watch this special weapon we pulled out.
Oh, yeah, but... You know, unfortunately, yesterday was not the best day to be a Newman Knight athletic-wise. We had six games/matches going on, and we were swept. But the baseball team took a hard loss to Delaware Valley University last week and a heartbreaking loss to Muhlenberg College last night. Nick Cullen started the game on the mound and went five innings, allowing five runs in nine hits. Thomas Carroll then stepped in for an inning, allowing two runs, one earned, and struck out three. Brendan Hatilia closed the game, allowing one run and striking out four. Newman scored a run in the first inning, but Muhlenberg scored four runs in the third for a 4-1 lead. Marcus White scored two more runs by the seventh inning, but Muhlenberg had built their lead 8-3. Muhlenberg held on tight for the win as the Knights started making a comeback. In the eighth, White knocked in Ryan Lopez with a double and then came around to score on a single by Andrew Curran. Zach Ray hit a double to bring in Philip Pfaffman, and Ray then scored on a single hit by Anthony Bassiano for an 8-7 score. In the ninth inning, Nick Glavocki hit a two-out double but could not come around for a run. The Knights open conference play as they take on Atlantic East Conference rival the Cabrini Cavaliers Friday at 3 p.m. and doubleheaders Saturday and Sunday at noon.
And if there is any team that is going to be extra busy in these coming weeks, it sure is our softball team here at Newman University. They are kicking it into high gear as every game from here on out is a doubleheader. The Knights went 1-1 in the doubleheader with Gwynn and Mercy University on Monday, losing the first game 5-2, then coming around to win the second 9-1. The ladies seemed to struggle, though, last night in their matchup against Stockton University. The Ospreys won by 8-0 and 11-6. In the first game, Stockton jumped on board early and Newman couldn't seem to get things rolling. In the second game, the Knights got on the board as Bree Rien walked and scored on a wild pitch. With bases loaded in the fourth, down by four, Ashley Light hit a double to bring in Rien, and Emily Reed, the Knights, used a pass ball, wild pitch, and an error to take a 6-5 lead after the top of the fourth. The Ospreys then took advantage of an error in the fifth to take back the lead and score three more runs. Our Knights hot Stephen Universe host Stevenson University on Thursday afternoon. First pitch is at 3 p.m. And I mean, our Knights are going to be hot against them.
Oh, sorry about that. I missed an S, but it's okay. Our men's golf team opened their spring season last week at the Eastern Invitational, only placing 7th out of 9. Chris Prizik led Newman, shooting an 85, and Mike McCrossin was a stroke behind with an 86 on the afternoon. The men stepped it up and finished 3rd out of 10 at the Lebanon Valley Dutchman Invitational. Captain of the golf team, Jared Christman, tied for first, shooting a 75 on a par 72 course. The team will head to Bluebell, PA on April 4th for the Knights Spring Invitational hosted by Arcadia University. So, good luck to our golf team, and I know that our intern, Mike McCrossin, is very excited for these upcoming tournaments.
Killing it on the green. You go. The men's lacrosse team picked up their 6th win of the season last Wednesday against Utica College 12-4. It was another dominating performance by the Knights, spreading the wealth with 8 players putting up points on the board. Coming off a 3-game winning streak, the Knights struggled on Saturday against Arcadia University, falling by a score of 21-7, resulting in their 2nd loss of the season. It was a slow start for Newman, with visitors punishing them quickly. The first quarter ended 5-0, but Arcadia kept rolling. Sam Nice tallied the first goal for Newman to make it 7-1 in the second and continued to score 3 unanswered goals in less than 2 minutes to cut the deficit to 7-4. Unfortunately, that is as close as the Knights would get. Arcadia was relentless, racking up in the lead in the third, 16-5. The men looked to shake off that tough loss and get right back into action today, traveling to Missicordia University. Face-off is at 4 p.m., so we wish them the best of luck.
Safe travels.
Get back on the win column.
Oh, yeah, and I think they will, and I think their next, like, big test will be Stockton.
Okay.
I was talking to the coach, and he said that a lot of the recruits that come are either Newman or Stockton. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, oh, it's going to be a really good game. Let's hope that the Knights can pull it out, but the women's lacrosse team had a tough loss to DeSales and could not, you know, pull out the win last Wednesday in a back-and-forth game. They then bounced back for a win over Eastern University 17-8. The Knights wasted no time asserting dominance by racing out to a 6-goal advantage in the opening quarter, led by Lindsay Fagan scoring a hat trick. Eastern bounced back in the second quarter, tightening the score 10-7. But that was the closest the hosts could get as Newman finished off the third quarter with four unanswered goals, heading into the final quarter 14-7. The Knights continued to roll as freshman Lauren Carson scored her first collegiate career goal, sandwiched by two more tallies from Fagan. This would be the fourth win for the team out of the last five, but the tables turned after last night's piss poor performance. The team traveled to Frederick, Maryland to play Hood College and lost 20-8. Lindsey Fagan paced the offense once again, but the team just could not seem to solve the Blazers' game tactics. Hood came out and scored four goals in the first stanza, but the Knights closed the lead 4-3. Hood continued to bring the heat as the Knights trailed 10-6 heading into halftime. Fagan cut the lead in the third, 10-7, but that's the closest the Knights could get to Hood scoring 10 goals in the remainder of the game. The ladies look to take revenge of the loss as they host Wilkes University tomorrow at 4. So I know that we're definitely looking for that win tomorrow. So show up, show out. It's going to be hopefully a beatdown.
Lots of revenge going to be served by the Knights this week. Oh, I could feel it. And the men's tennis team opened their 2022 spring season with a 5-4 win over Penn State Brandywine. The Knights opened doubles, taking two of the 3 points. Daniel Banowski and Justin McCullen teamed up for an 8-4 win, along with Vince Landis and Anthony Carpinella, picking up a win for the second doubles match. McCullen, Landis, and Joe Troilo won their matches to seal the deal for the Knights' knockout. Unfortunately, the men and women lost to Lancaster Bible College yesterday evening and don't have another match until the women take on Cedar Crest College on Saturday at 1. So, you know, a little bit of here, a little bit of there. Maybe they'll get back in the win column too.
Let's hope so. And maybe we could get Joe Troilo to come on and interview.
Yeah,
him,
he's being a little bit camera shy, but I'm working on it.
Well, yes, work on him. He'll be here in a few weeks, no doubt about it. But the men's and women's track and field team officially start their outdoor season this Friday and Saturday at the Susquehanna Invitational. So, and we have a special interview coming up with track and field and hockey and cross country superstar Devin Joyce. So stay tuned.
Hello, and we're back. We have the pleasure to sit down with Devin Joyce. He is our first three-sport athlete coming on the show. So, Devin, thank you for coming on.
No problem.
And Devin plays hockey here at Newman University. He plays, runs track and field and cross country. So, Devin, to start off, tell us a little bit about what it's like being a multi-sport athlete and, you know, how you came to be one.
That's a good question. Hockey, I've always played hockey, so I see that as a sport. Funny enough, I don't really see like track and field or cross country as like a sport. It's more or less just a hobby. It all started actually COVID when the gyms closed, and I was like, I got to stay active some way. I was like, so I just started running. I was like, it's pretty fun. So I was like, and then I came here during, I guess, like COVID, and yeah, we had a track team. So I was like, let me try that out. Tried that out, and then they were like, hey, you should sign up for cross country next year. I was like, all right, I'll do that too. So, and now, yeah, three sports.
Great way to stay fit, stay involved, and keep the mind running.
I know. Yeah. I don't know how you do it. Like, I'm stressed just in one season, and I feel like you have to be so on top of it. How crazy busy are you?
Very busy. Yeah, usually days start like around like 5:30, 6, just so I can get the run in and whatever. But that's what I'm saying. Like around like the whole track and field and cross country, like, I don't see it as a sport. Like hockey, like I was stressed out because I was like, I got to make it to practice, got to like have good practice, have to also like worry about schoolwork. Like running is like just a way to like, I guess, like escape and just like kind of just like run and clear your mind. So it's a good way to start the day.
Yeah, more on your own schedule, on your own time. Mm-hmm. And so now we know you are training for an Ironman triathlon.
On top of everything else.
Yes, he could never do more. But tell us more about what that is. What that entails, the training, the rigor of the training.
What made you want to do that, sign up for that?
Again, COVID. Like, when I found out, I was like, all right, like, I'm not too bad at running, and, like, we always have to bike, like, for training for hockey and stuff. I was like, let's just throw a little wrench in the plan and learn how to swim. Well, I kind of sink, but I was like, it'd be fun. So I did that all last summer, and then I was like, all right, let's try and, like, ramp it up here, and, like, let's really try and go after something crazy. And I found out like what an Ironman was, which is like a 2.4 mile swim, 112 mile bike, right, and do like a full marathon, so like 26.2 miles. You do it all like through a stretch of one day as fast as you can. So yeah, I just started training for that. Training started the day after Christmas. I had to start December 26th, and I'll race in the end of July up in Lake Placid, New York.
Wow, that's so exciting though. Like,
yeah.
Imagine, it's like, I don't know, like I can't even put it into words, like that's so, how long is it supposed to take you?
All depends on the course, if it's like a flat course or a hilly course, of course. If like you got a lot of hills, you got to climb, it's going to be a lot harder, which Lake Placid is very hilly.
Yeah.
I think it's like a total of like 8,000 feet of elevation. Yeah, so it can range, like the pros finish like around 8 hours, and it can take, I think they cut you off around like 16 hours.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so you're out there. Wow. When it's dark, and then as soon as like sunrise starts, like they shoot the gun and you can like start swimming, and then
so once you it's do dark, start with the swim.
Yeah, you start with the swim and then into the bike and then into the run. I think it's like just like for safety hazards.
Yeah,
just
probably
because like, you don't want to be sinking.
Yeah. Well, you sure do not let grass grow under your feet, especially during COVID, which is admirable because you know you had that free time and you could choose to do whatever you want. But on top of that, you use, not only is it for yourself, but you also have like a fitness page, right, as well. So like motivate others and maybe get them like off the couch trying something they never knew they could do before. So
yeah, that was not my intentions at all. Yeah, that was totally my roommate, T-Mac. He's like a big artist. I mean, if you want to follow him instead of mine, I would definitely recommend Cam T-Art.
But, you can shout him out too.
Yeah, definitely him. I don't know, just for fun, maybe like look back and see like where I started and like where I'm at now.
That would be awesome. No, I see like your weekly summaries and I'm just like, I even think I can run that much in a month. Oh my goodness.
Motivation. Yeah, but absolutely. Gearing more a little bit towards hockey in the season you guys had this year, tell us a little bit about like how that was, how that went, and moving forward to next season.
I don't know. I thought we had a overall, like the past 3 years that I've been here, I thought like the environment and like the community with the guys was just like much better and just like improved a lot. Like it seemed like everybody like wanted to be there. Everybody was having fun. And I mean, really, it's kind of what you want. Like you don't want to like regret it. So I think we have a lot of room for improvement. Coach is making us do a lot of off-ice training this summer. So hopefully we're ready to go next year.
Yeah, maybe bring back a championship.
Yep,
that'd be a good way to go out.
Yeah. Yeah, they could be right on there on top with the men's basketball team.
Absolutely.
But should we move on to our time 10?
We should. Devin, this is the most fun part of this segment. It's called time 10, and you have to answer these 10 questions in less than a minute, and you get a date in the calf with Mike McCrossin.
Oh, nice. All right.
Which is exactly what you want.
Yeah, that's what I want. Yeah. Sounds good.
Sorry, Katie. Anyways.
All right, so 1 minute on the clock, and go.
What has more in the world, doors or wheels?
Wheels.
If there is a sport you wanted to play, but you didn't.
Baseball.
Celebrity crush.
I don't know, Megan Fox.
Dream vacation.
Oh my God, think. I don't know, Hawaii.
Disney or Nickelodeon?
Disney.
If you could be stuck on an island with anyone in the world, who would it be?
Katie.
If you could have a conversation with a famous figure, dead or alive, who would it be?
The Rock, Dwayne Johnson.
One unique characteristic or trait about yourself?
I like to run.
When you were little, what did you want to be when you grew up?
A hockey player.
Favorite restaurant and why?
Spasso's, Italian. It's great.
Love that. Way to
great
go.
One.
And wow. That was awesome.
That was good. Was it under a minute or no?
Sure.
Yep, it was under a minute. They said it. Yep. So with that, your prize is a dinner at Spasso with Mike McCrossin.
Nice.
So I'm sure you will enjoy that. But Devin, thank you again for coming on. It was a pleasure. And all the best of luck in the triathlon.
The Ironman
triathlon. Yes. And thank you guys again. We'll catch you next week with another episode of The Sports Shift. Have a great weekend.